Southern Baptists say their intention is to share God's gospel with members of the Jewish faith. Jews say the aim is conversion and an insult to their creed. Joining us for an in-depth debate about this controversy, Rabbi Marvin Heyer, founder and dean of the Simon Wiesenthal Center, Rabbi Shmuley Boteach, executive director of the Oxford Lachaim Society. In Louisville, Kentucky, R. Albert Moeller, Jr., president of the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary, and David Brickner, executive director of Jews for Jesus. They're all next on Larry King Live. Good evening. Welcome to another edition of Larry King Live, a raging debate in the religious community and beyond as the Southern Baptists, who are going to gather in Chicago, are asking their members to proselytize the faith and to convert Jews. Indeed, they're giving out pamphlets. This one aimed at the Jewish faith is called Days of Awe, Prayers for Jews. There are also pamphlets on prayers for Hindus and prayers for Muslims. Let's start with Albert Moeller, Jr., president of the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary. He's in Louisville. What is the aim here, Albert?
In this endeavor, Southern Baptists are about, Larry, what we've always been about from the beginning, and that is sharing the gospel of salvation through Jesus Christ to all persons, Jew and Gentile, rich and poor, young and old. This is in faithfulness to the Great Commission of our Lord Jesus Christ, and it is the heart of the Christian mission.
So the goal is then you want Jews to convert. What do you want Jews to do? Listen to you and do what?
Our prayer is that all persons would hear the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ and respond in faith. We believe that the gospel is for all persons, regardless of any kind of ethnic identity. We believe in sharing the gospel without any discrimination, and that all persons are in need of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. And it is our responsibility to share that gospel.
Rabbi Heyer, you may disagree, but it's free speech. He can proselytize. You can listen or not listen. What's the big deal?
Absolutely. I've had plenty Jehovah Witnesses come to my doorstep. This is a free country. The issue here, however, is their methodology. They're using deception. If you look at that pamphlet, Days of Awe, they're talking about Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. In many instances, they've had programs with Jewish religious music, wearing yarmulkes. Some people have been invited as speakers that have put on a prayer shawl, a talis. If you have something to sell, be straight about it. Just say, we're trying to sell Christianity, we're Christians, here are our Christian symbols. Don't adopt somebody else's symbols. We're not selling a car.
They're designing it for subterfuge.
That's correct.
All right. What is the position in this, David, of Jews for Jesus? Well, briefly explain that organization, because you're not Christian, are you?
Well, we are Jewish people who have come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah and the Savior of the world, that he died and rose again to pay the penalty for our sins.
You don't celebrate Christian holidays, right?
Well, we are 100% Jewish and 100% Christian. We are like the first Jews for Jesus.
You get every holiday off.
That's right. Okay. We have two for the price of one. Peter, James, and John were the first Jews for Jesus. And Jesus himself is Jewish.
So you believe the Messiah has come and it is Jesus.
That's correct. Right.
What do you think of what the Southern Baptists are doing?
Well, I'm not a Southern Baptist, as you said.
I know that, but what do you think of what they're doing?
I'm proud of them. I applaud their efforts because they care enough to love my Jewish people. And the most loving thing that you can do is share the love of God in the Messiah Jesus.
So any way they do it is fine as long as they bring that message.
Well, it's important for people to be able to appeal to individuals in a certain way that communicates effectively. And this is not about subterfuge, and this is not about appropriating symbols. After all, Jesus himself used Jewish symbols.
He was Jewish.
He was Jewish. And so the message of faith in him is a very Jewish message.
Rabbi Boteach, do you agree with Rabbi Heyer that they're using subterfuge? This is wrong?
Well, I would say, Larry, it goes well beyond using subterfuge. I mean, who would have thought that in a new millennium we would once again see the prevalence of spiritual dictatorship and totalitarianism? I mean, basically, the Nazis said there's a problem with the Jewish body, so let's find a solution. And these groups are saying there's a problem with the Jewish soul, we have another solution. It's called conversion. You have to be like us or we can't love you. If you're not like us, you're going to go to the eternal barbecue. This is a nefarious, insipid message which has led to inquisitions, auto-de-fés, pogroms, expulsions, and ultimately the Holocaust.
Are you against, therefore, any attempt of any religion at conversion? If a religion attempts conversion, is it saying, I'm better than you?
I am absolutely against any religion that says that one faith is superior to another. I don't see how that is anything different than spiritual racism. It's a way of saying that we are closer to God than you, and that's what leads to hatred. And far from it being, this is not just something which is innocent. You know, 2,000 years of Christian anti-Judaism led directly to racial anti-Semitism. It culminated in the Holocaust. And real, honest Christian scholars are now looking back at Christian theology and saying that verses like Matthew that say that the Jews took upon themselves the blood of Christ, or John, which says that the Jews are the children of the devil, prepared to do the bidding of their father at any time, have to be re-examined, reinterpreted, and reapplied because too many Jews have suffered. I mean, I find
Let's stop. We got a lot of time. Albert Mola, how do you respond to what both rabbis have said?
Well, I'm very disappointed. First, using words like deception and subterfuge, and now speaking of anti-Semitism, this is not about anti-Semitism, and it's certainly not about deception. I don't believe in any form of evangelism that would involve deception. And one thing Southern Baptists are seldom charged with is subtlety. We are right up front about what we are doing. Otherwise, there would not be this response. So
rabbis, let him finish, and then we'll respond.
But the issue of the charge of anti-Semitism is especially disappointing, since American evangelicals are the best friends in many ways that the Jewish people can have. We defend their right of religious liberty, but it is in the very heart of the gospel that we are to share the gospel of salvation through Jesus Christ to all persons. And, you know, when it comes to the issue of the claims that the belief that the Christian gospel is the only gospel and that Jesus is the only Savior, that that's totalitarian, I find that very strange, coming from people whose own book in the Old Testament speaks about the one true God over against the false God.
Rabbi Heyer, are you afraid of? Well, hold on, Rabbi.
First, let me say this, that regarding their love, it's wonderful that Southern Baptists are expressing this kind of love.
Pro-Israel,
I have no problem with that. Israel needs all the support it can get. We should recognize, however, that in 2,000 years, that love was lacking. And when we really needed it and the chips were down, there was no one there. During the Holocaust, we didn't hear those words of love.
But it's kind of
hypocritical now, when Jews have come out of the Holocaust, when there are 13.5 million Jews in the world, there are 5 billion people on this planet, that there's nobody else to convert but 13.5 million people who just lost 1/3 of the Jewish people in the Holocaust.
But if they believe fully in this is the way to salvation and to heaven, why not spread that?
As I said before, Larry, if they feel very strongly about it, meet me in the street or anybody else, or meet Larry King in the street and say, Larry, I'd like to convert you, but I'm a Christian. Don't come and use subterfuge, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and a shofar. Since when are those? Those are not Christian symbols.
We'll pick right up in a minute. We'll be including your phone calls. It's our subject for the full hour. Don't go away. David Brickner, how do Jews for Jesus get converts?
We go out on the streets and we hand out gospel tracts. We wear T-shirts that say Jews for Jesus. We have a website, www.jewsforjesus.org. We have thousands of people we're in 10 countries around the world, including Israel.
And your thought is to make Jews Christians or to make Jews what?
What we're looking to do is to engage, to explain and to share with our Jewish people the love of God, that God sent Jesus the Messiah to suffer, to die for our sins. He rose again from the dead, and that by putting our faith and trust in Him, we can have forgiveness for all our sins, past, present, and future. Now that's a message of love. It's a message of hope, and it's one that we want to share not just with Jewish people, but with all people.
Rabbi Boteach, what argument could you have with that?
Well, Larry, you know, the United States has come clean about its history of racism. There was a civil rights movement which sought to establish equality. I think Christian leaders like Mr. Brickner have to come clean and say, what kind of love is it when I can only love you on my terms? If you don't become like me, I believe you're going to the eternal barbecue. I mean, the fact is that talk of salvation means that Jews are not being saved, even with their own faith. It means that German Nazis who gassed Jews but did it amidst a belief in Christ are today in heaven. But the Jewish victims, like a million children who were turned into lampshades and into soap because they died with the wrong faith, are today in hell. I find that perverse.
See. Now, Albert Mola, are you saying, let me get this clear, because I know that Billy Graham has been quoting these statements over the weekend.
Where did Jews go to don't believe in Christ?
All right, that's the question. I'll ask it, Rabbi. Albert Mohler, if you do not believe in Christ and you die, Jewish or anyone, what happens to you?
I believe it says that those who reject Christ, those who do not accept Christ, those who do not believe in Christ, will die, and when they are raised in the resurrection, they will face the judgment of God, and they will be consigned to hell. That is not something I came up with. That's not something that Southern Baptists came up with. That is in the New Testament. It is central to New Testament Christianity. And thus, it is important to us to do everything.
So you're saying is you are condemned if you don't accept. Well, all right, now, yes, this is a key
Larry,
point. Okay.
Doesn't that sound a bit to you like if you don't have blonde hair and blue eyes, you're going to be go up in a furnace?
Unless, Rabbi, I can give you blonde hair and blue eyes. And he's saying he can give you the salvation.
How would we Americans react if the KKK introduced a prayer for all blacks to become white? How would we react if masculine male movements introduced some sort of prayer that all women should have sex change operations and embrace the real
superior
gender?
That's a little different
gender.
Than changing
the
philosophy.
The rabbi knows he's being ludicrous here, and frankly, these examples are not helpful at all. This is about sharing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are sharing that as a gift.
Okay.
We are
that's
not
what
imposing
I'm getting at.
That on the Jewish
Rabbi
people.
Heyer, well, that's important. If he just believes that if you die and you don't accept this, you're going to go to hell, and he would like to send you to heaven, he's trying to help you. What's wrong with that?
There's nothing wrong with that, as I said before, if he feels that strongly. What's wrong is their methodology. They're very deceptive about it. They're using our symbols. And more than that, you know, how would the Southern Baptists like it if next Christmas Eve they woke up to a full-page ad in the New York Times from a group of atheists that invite everyone to a midnight mass, and when they come to the mass, there are crosses and sacred vestments, and all these atheist preachers get up and convince the congregation to become atheists. The Southern Baptists would lead the protests against that, and that's what they're doing to the Jews.
Larry, that is not true. I don't understand this charge of deception. We are not doing anything that Rabbi Heyer is here suggesting. We're very upfront about what we're doing, and the prayer book you held up was intended for Baptist Christians to use in praying for their Jewish friends. It wasn't even intended to present to the Jewish people directly at all.
I'm looking at it now, Rabbi. It tells what each day of Rosh Hashanah, each day of the New Year is, what the group is seeking from it, and what they get from it. It's sort of explaining Judaism to the non-Jew.
Larry, that's not true. It says on the last page, for example, they asked for prayers for the Jews who are unfortunately caught up with materialism.
It calls them lost sheep. And I mean, this really is an outrageous
deceptive document
that purports to be a prayer book. I mean, listen to some of the, pray that the Jewish people are free of the strong influence of materialism in the land where they live. I mean, what kind of Jewish stereotypes are we catering to? They also say that Jews should see lives of righteous integrity, which will provoke them to consider the claims of serving the Messiah, of those serving the Messiah. I mean, are they inferring that Jews don't have integrity? Are they inferring, they also say,
well, would you support that statement?
I don't believe it's a stereotype. I believe it's true of all people,
materialism,
Jews and Gentiles
Jews
alike,
that
materialism can be a problem.
Did they say materialism regarding Muslims?
I'm not sure. But I think that the real
issue
here is...
And Larry,
Rabbi, do not interrupt.
Okay. I think the real issue is whether or not Jesus is the Messiah, because he claimed to be the Messiah, and Jesus himself used Jewish symbols. So the rabbi's argument is not with the Southern Baptists, it's not with Jews for Jesus, it's with Jesus and his disciples.
That's not
true. And if Jesus is not the Jewish Messiah...
If he said he was the Messiah, you disagree with him.
But once Jesus left the Jewish people and his disciples created a new religion, they are two separate religions.
But he didn't create a religion, did
no,
he?
No, his disciples did. They created Christianity.
In his name.
And therefore, if you can be either Jewish or Christian.
You don't
you can't
believe you
be,
can
both.
Be both.
You cannot be, if you ask a person politically, what are you? And he says, I'm a Democrat and I'm a Republican. Or somebody else will say, I'm an atheist and I'm a Christian. Impossible. You're one or the other.
Albert Mueller, are you hurt by Billy Graham's remark that, here's what Billy said, I normally defend my denomination, I'm loyal to it, and he is a Southern Baptist, but I've never targeted Muslims and I've never targeted Jews. What do you make of what Billy said?
Well, I know and love Dr. Billy Graham and respect him highly, and the one thing I know about Dr. Billy Graham is that he believes in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ and in the need for all persons to come to faith and repentance in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I know he believes that that is true for the Jews, no less than for others, and no more. And I hold to the same position, and so do the Southern Baptists. We don't believe that Jews are any more in need of the gospel than anyone else, but they are no less in need of the gospel.
We'll pick up with Rabbi Botayak when we come back. Here's what Billy Graham said this past weekend. Watch.
I'm a Southern Baptist, and I normally defend my denomination. I'm loyal to it. I believe in them. They have some of the finest people in the world in that denomination. But I have never targeted Muslims. I've never targeted Jews. I believe that we should declare the fact that God loves you, God's willing to forgive you, God can change you.
Rabbi Botayak, I've interviewed Billy Graham many times. When I asked him about this, about death and salvation and heaven and hell, he said that he's not going to judge it because maybe everybody at death does find Christ. So he's never going to try to convert Jews. Would you agree that that's a fair opinion to have, that maybe when a Jew dies at the moment of death, he or she finds Christ?
I mean,
is that a fair statement?
About Jews?
It's not a prejudice statement. Yeah, about Jews or anyone.
Well, I mean, it's certainly not true of the Jews that I know. They die, they were born as Jews, they die as Jews, and they retain their faith throughout their lifetime. I mean, we Jews have shown a phenomenal tenacity throughout history to sustain our belief system amidst a compulsion and often coercion to do otherwise. I mean, I basically believe as a Jew that Billy Graham is a great man. Reverend Moeller is probably very close to God. I do not believe I have a copyright on truth as a Jew. I believe that my Judaism is true for Jews in the same way feminism may be true for women. But I do believe that I'm not being accorded that same spiritual right to exercise my proximity to God by the people I'm hearing tonight. I mean, Jews for Jesus is like saying Americans for communism or Hindus for Allah. I mean, give me a break. These are two contradictory
systems. Well, you're entitled to be an American for communism if you wish.
Okay, well, right? An American for Stalin, whatever it might be. My simple point is that I have to go beyond Rabbi Heyer. I cannot accept that there is a morality and a spiritual system which denigrates me as a Jew and says that I'm going to burn in hell. Even though I've lived a good life, an ethical life, even though I have told the truth and been honest with my children, I am amazed at what I'm hearing tonight. This is the 21st century, for goodness
David,
sake. This barbaric element which has entered into religion has got to be put aside.
David,
no
what
more
happens
spiritual
in hell?
Apartheid.
What happens in hell?
I don't know.
Do you think?
But what I do
you're
think...
You're saying you're condemned to hell, right, if you don't believe. You share
well,
this...
Even if you're a good person. Even if
Jesus
you're a good
said,
person.
Way
don't interrupt.
Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the
if
Father but by me.
If you don't believe that, you go to hell.
Yes.
What happens in hell?
Which is eternal separation from God. It's the sum total of the choices that we make.
It's just 24 hours of despair. It's what?
We don't know a whole lot about it from what the Bible tells us, but we know it's not a place we want to go.
And do Jews believe in hell?
Jews believe in hell, but that, Larry, is just ridiculous. That
well,
and
according to the Jew, who goes to heaven, who no. goes to hell?
Every good person, we have a statement in the Talmud that says that you're judged on deeds.
A good atheist goes to heaven.
You cannot, it's not for, we're not God. We don't have the keys to heaven. But God is not going to deny Mahatma Gandhi. And he's not going to deny great humanitarians. For example, today you have the Dalai Lama. So we're going to say, because he didn't verbalize a belief, if a man is a good person, he merits heaven.
And don't you believe that, Albert Mohler? Doesn't that make sense to you?
Unfortunately, not. No,
so therefore, the Dalai Mahatma Gandhi is not in heaven.
All I know is that the only way to heaven is through personal faith and belief in the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior. And
so
no matter how
person?
Good or bad by human estimation, the fact is that before God, we are all sinners in need of a Savior. There is not one who is good. No, not one, says the Scriptures. Larry, something very basic is important here. And to an outsider, this Jewish debate looks very strange. And I'll tell you why. It seems that the Jewish leadership in America will make great allowances for the fact that perhaps a majority of American Jews, according to polls, no longer believe in a personal God. But one can be an atheist and still be supposedly a good Jew. But the moment a Jew believes that Jesus Christ is the Messiah, he is told he is no longer a Jew. I don't think that makes sense to very many people, and it certainly makes no sense regarding the gospel
right.
of the Lord.
I'll have the rabbi respond to that. It's very well brought up, and let him respond, and we'll do that right after this. Rabbi Heyer and the other rabbi will respond. Don't go away. Right, Rabbi Heyer, Albert Mohler says it looks ridiculous that the Jews would take an atheist and say he can go to heaven or anyone can go to heaven, but if a Jew converts, he can't go, he doesn't go to heaven.
Well, first of all, neither Albert nor I nor anyone here, we're not the ticket masters to heaven. Nobody asked us to give out the tickets. The tickets to heaven are decided by God. And in Judaism, there's a belief, Chassidei Umot HaOlam, the righteous of all nations, Yeshlam Chelek LeOlam Abo. We receive all the merits of heaven. And we do not believe that there's one train, board this train, because if you're not on this train, you're not going to heaven.
But that's, you believe that's there ridiculous. Is a judge, a God who is judging
us. Of course,
this,
and it's for God to decide. He didn't give over his job to us. We have a lot of human beings running around that want to act in the name of God.
Makes you, David, the decider?
Thank God I don't have to decide. I don't have to decide. Rabbi's right. God is the one who judges.
So?
But I don't know about you, Larry, but I'm not righteous. I know that about myself. I don't live up to God's standard of holiness, and that's why he sent Jesus the Messiah to die for our sins and rise again. Jesus is the only righteous person who lived on the face of this earth, and because of that, he could pay the penalty for our sin. Because of that, we can have forgiveness and we can know the love of God. And that's the basis on which God judges.
Rabbi Boteach, you were going to respond?
Yeah, David, that sounds to me like the abrogation of responsibility. I mean, if you say that you're not righteous, I would advise you to try and be a better person. If you gossip, stop gossiping. If you ever tell untruths, then tell the truth. If you can be a better father and a better husband, then do so. But to abrogate your personal responsibility and say that faith will set you free and remain a person who is unrighteous and try to excuse your bad behavior, I think that every citizen of a democratic country like the United States has obligations to try to better themselves, not just spiritually, but materially as well. But even if you believe that, it's not for me to condemn your faith system, but why don't you just let us be? I believe that, as Rabbi Heyer said so eloquently, that Christians are very close to God. Our greatest Jewish thinker of all time, Maimonides, said 850 years ago, in an age that wasn't particularly religiously enlightened, that Christianity has brought the knowledge of God to the distant shores, brought millions closer to God. We wrote in our Talmud 2,000 years ago that a non-Jew who loves God and is a good human being is as holy as our high priest, for goodness sake. I would advise you to turn back to your Jewish roots and embrace that kind of inclusivism. I would advise you to embrace tolerance, because clearly your belief system that you've now adopted is leading you to be intolerant. You want to convert your Jewish brethren to a spiritual totalitarian system. And just let us be. We're going to live our life,
Albert,
as Jews, and we're going to love God.
Albert Mohler, what was wrong with what he just said?
Well, again, it sounds very strange, because when one reads the Old Testament, what the rabbis would call the Hebrew Scriptures, there what you see is God claiming to be the one true and living God, the God of Israel. He calls the other gods the false gods. He says he is a jealous God. He says his way is life, the other ways are death. And now yet what we're hearing from these rabbis is it's just laissez-faire, whatever one wants. It's a great banquet out there. Come and eat whatever you want, and all roads lead to heaven. That's
where does
just
it say that
Judaism
is the only path? No, Reverend Mohler, you are telling an untruth. Where does it say anywhere in Hebrew Scripture that Judaism is the only path to truth? We have no verses like
Judaism.
We have no verses. You are telling an untruth. We have no verses that say none shall come unto the Father.
If you're going to do all the talking,
we have no verses that say.
Rabbi, let him answer. Rabbi, you've posed a question. You stop and let him answer. Go. Albert.
The Bible speaks, just for instance, Elijah on Mount Carmel, where the one true God is over against the prophets of the false gods, and he shows himself to be the one true God. He is a jealous God. The issue isn't Judaism, but the identity of the God who has revealed himself in Scripture, the God who in the Old Testament and in the New speaks through his word. And this gets to the issue raised by Rabbi Heyer. I didn't come up with this understanding of the gospel, and Southern Baptists didn't come up with this. This is in the text of Scripture itself. We're seeking to be a scriptural people. This is what God has revealed in his word.
If you want to be scriptural,
let me just add to what was discussed there. You know, our point is that, of course, God is the judge of all human beings. What we're saying, however, is that we should not take God's job away from him. God did not say anywhere that we will determine who goes to heaven. It is Judaism's emphatic belief that the people who go to heaven are people who lived lives of quality based on deeds. What you say with your mouth is cheap talk. Adolf Eichmann, before he died, a Protestant minister wanted to speak to him because he said if he could only get at him, and Eichmann turned him down, he would get him to heaven. Now, isn't that preposterous? A man lived a life of misdeeds, and he's going to go to heaven because he says, I believe in Jesus Christ, but a Jewish child who was gassed at Auschwitz, she's going to hell.
Let me get a break and come back. We'll include your phone calls. We're only halfway through. Jeffrey Toobin tomorrow night. This is Larry King Live. Bill Ginsburg returns on Friday. Don't go away. We're back with Rabbi Marvin Heyer, founder and dean of the Simon Wiesenthal Center in Los Angeles. In New York is Rabbi Shmuley Boteach. He is executive director of the Oxford L'Chaim Society. In Louisville, Kentucky is R. Albert Moeller, Jr., president of the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary. And in Los Angeles, David Brickner, executive director, Jews for Jesus. The caller is from Laverne, California. Hello.
Hello, Larry.
Hi.
Hi, my question is for Reverend Moeller. I am a Christian, and my Bible tells me that if someone doesn't know about Christ, it's my duty to tell them. However, since the Jewish people do know about him, don't you think you're interfering in God's business since he tells us to judge not, lest ye be judged?
No, not at all. I think I understand what you're asking, but I don't believe for a moment that all the Jewish people understand the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I think there's a massive mission field out there across America of persons, Jew and Gentile, who have no understanding of the gospel, and it is our responsibility to confront them with the gospel. Again, we cannot coerce faith, and we would not seek to do so. What we hope to do is present the claims of Christ as the Messiah, the Savior, the Lord of all, and hope that persons will be brought to faith and repentance in him.
La Mesa, New Mexico. Hello.
Hello. I would just like to say that I believe that there is one God overall. So what is the conflict? I mean, isn't that, what we're all talking about?
David Brickner, you don't believe that. You believe there's one God overall, right?
Yes.
The conflict is, who's the road to him?
Absolutely. And the issue is whether or not Jesus really is the Messiah. He claimed to be. He claimed to be the one sent from God to bring us back to the Father. And that's what we believe. And so the issue really is not a conflict between Judaism and Southern Baptist, but a question. Is Jesus the Messiah? I believe he is, and I just happen to believe that if my Jewish people knew what I know about Jesus, they'd want to love and follow him.
As
too.
A loving Messiah, if he were here right now, hold it, Rabbi, if Jesus were here right now as a loving Messiah, and Rabbi Heyer or Rabbi Boteach would say to him, I love you, but I don't think you're the Messiah, Jesus would condemn them to hell?
I think if Rabbi Heyer met Jesus right here, that he would honor him and worship him as the Messiah of Israel.
Would Jesus Christ say, you're going to hell?
Absolutely, because Jesus said that before. We know
the loving Christ would send the rabbi to hell for not believing in him.
No, all of us. There are no Jews in hell. There are no Holocaust survivors in hell. There are only sinners in hell. And sin separates us from God.
Are you a sinner if you don't believe in the Messiah?
All of us are sinners.
So you could be in hell.
Yeah, absolutely. Except for the fact that I've embraced God's forgiveness in the person of Jesus.
So, Rabbi Boteach, under that concept, do you think you're going to hell?
Look, Larry, listening to some of these conversations, I don't know if I'm here already. I thought I was living in an enlightened world where people respected each other and had tolerance. I mean, this caller asked a brilliant question. There's one God. As long as we get to him, then what's the difference about the path? Everything that Reverend Moeller quoted about Elijah, I mean, God was trying to destroy idols. Is Reverend Moeller really implying that we Jews sort of bow down to mammon? Is he saying that we sort of worship the sun and the moon? We worship the one God. He gets there as well. So do the Muslims. I think all these religions are beautiful. Let's join together as brothers and sisters. Let's end intolerance once and for all. Religion has caused so much aggravation, so much suffering. This is not just an intelligent debate on TV. This is a subject which has led to my people being turned into, lampshades and auto-de-fés and crusades.
Rabbi, that's an emotional appeal and well done. However, if someone has a sincere belief that Christ is the answer and wants to share that with you, why are you hanging the Holocaust around his neck? He wants to share a belief with you.
Well, Larry, what if an Aryan has a sincere belief that having blonde hair and blue eyes really is superior to having a dark color of skin?
As long as he doesn't kill you and he tells you he has an opinion. If you were blonde and blue eyes, you'd be a better person. That's what I feel. Now, I can ostracize him. I can believe him. I'm not going to shoot him. He could be a good person.
Racist beliefs lead to racist action, and Christian anti-Judaism leads to racial anti-Semitism.
Okay,
and every historian knows that to be true, and that's why these beliefs are dangerous.
And let me add to that. You know, in the United States, Larry, we've come out of a terrible period of our own history where during the Civil Rights Movement, African Americans were asked to go to the back of the bus. When people call Jews incomplete Jews, because we don't recognize Jesus Christ, we're incomplete Jews.
That's a term.
That's sending all the Jewish people to the back of the bus. And it's very much discriminatory.
Do you use that term?
Absolutely.
Mr. Albert Mola, you use that term, incomplete Jews?
I've never heard it. Okay. It's in their literature.
You use it, Albert?
I have not characteristically used that term, but I affirm what it intends to mean, and that is a Jew that has not received Jesus the Messiah. Definitely, we believe that Jesus is the Messiah of the Jews and of all the nations, and that want to be complete in faith, one must receive him and accept him. You know, Larry, one of the best things I heard asked on this program is, if Jesus were before us, what would he say? I believe the best thing to do is to quote him. Two statements. Come unto me, all ye who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That's wonderful. The second statement is just as true. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. That isn't something we made up. That is from the statement of Jesus himself.
Reverend Mola, can I quote to you Matthew chapter 5, verse 18, where Jesus says that he came to the world in order to fulfill the law, and that anyone who doesn't keep every aspect of the law, he uses the words in the Hebrew of the kotz of a yud, a little tiny piece of a letter of the law, is not fulfilled. Reverend Mola, do you keep kosher? Do you drive on the Sabbath? Do you wear tzitzis, the little fringes that we wear? Do you wear a yarmulke? And if you don't, why don't you live by everything that Jesus said? I mean, why did you abrogate the law? So you're going to give me a
contortion.
Let him answer, Rabbi. It's a fair question. Albert, why don't you do all the things Jesus did?
Because Jesus did not instruct us to live that way. In fact, Jesus made the point that there is not one of us who is righteous according to the law, that he is the only one who is righteous by the law.
So you don't live by what he lived? In other words, he wore a yarmulke, but you don't. He benched Sillin, you don't. He ate kosher, you don't.
Jesus wore a yarmulke, but what Jesus also did was to tell us that we should live by his word, and the New Testament gives us very clear indications. It is not a Judaizing that we experience as Gentiles coming to Christ. Paul and Peter fought that out in the book of Acts, and the Lord made his decision very clear.
We'll come right back with our guests and more of your phone calls. Don't go away. We're back, and we go to Phoenix, Arizona. Hello.
Hi there.
Hi.
I would like to ask the rabbis, since we're talking about Christ as the Messiah, what are the qualifications they are looking for in the Messiah, and why hasn't Jesus filled those qualifications?
Rabbi Heyer.
Well, the reason that Jesus is not accepted as the Messiah by the Jewish people is that Jesus is viewed as divine. The Jews do not believe in any other divine being except God himself.
Don't you believe the Messiah is coming?
Yes, but the Messiah that we believe is coming could be somebody that flunks mathematics in university. He is not infallible, not divine, and would be a student or a disciple of Moses, who by far would be considered greater than the Messiah.
How do you know he hasn't come?
Because the world is still in turmoil. We're told that when the Messiah comes, we will all live in peace and tolerance. And since we know that hasn't happened, we know for sure that the Messiah has not come.
Okay.
Can I just add that even though the Jews don't believe that Jesus was not the Messiah, does not mean that we haven't been enriched by his teachings. I am an Orthodox rabbi who has read the New Testament cover to cover many times. I think some of the ethical teachings in Christianity are incredibly moving. I love Christian faith. I love how my Christian brethren refer to God as a close friend. They use the word Lord, which we Jews don't normally use in everyday conversation. We Jews have much to learn from our Christian brethren. But there is one great teaching in Judaism, and that is man is not God. There is an infinite quantum gap that separates the two. And we don't like the fact that this faith and this belief has been superimposed upon us by the sword. I mean, we've been given this terrible choice of choosing life and choosing Christianity throughout our history.
Yeah.
And I think that it's time to stop. Important point, I mean, the Messiah has got to be someone who brings world peace. There's no world peace. The Messiah is someone who's resurrected the dead. We haven't resurrected the dead. Even Christianity says there has to be a second coming because none of the messianic prophecies have been fulfilled. And you know what? We'll sit and wait and see who does it. But the point really is, In the meantime, the world isn't Jewish and Christian anymore. It's religious and secular. Instead of Reverend Mohler seeing us Jews as the victims who need to be uplifted spiritually, see us as brothers, join with us to bring greater spirituality to a very materialistic world.
David, would you agree that a lot of what has been said here tonight is true? A lot is in the name of Christianity, Jews have been persecuted.
Well, I'd like to point out, here's the minority report. There are some of us Jews who do believe that Jesus is the Messiah, who do believe that there are messianic prophecies concerning a suffering servant who would come and suffer and die for the sins of the people and rise again.
But it couldn't be Jesus.
And those of us who believe that are no less Jewish. We embrace our Jewishness and we embrace Jesus as the Messiah, and we long to tell our own Jewish people about that.
Was he supposed to bring world peace, and was he supposed to resurrect the dead?
The first and most important place that peace begins is in the heart. Peace is not something that's forced from outside. It begins in the heart, and that's what Jesus brought. He brought peace between God and men, and
no,
he is
Isaiah
coming
says,
again,
Isaiah
and he will
says
bring
that
peace
man has to be
on the earth when he returns.
You're interrupting again. Albert, you were going to say?
Yes, I was going to say, I understand the rabbi says about the infinite distinction between God and man, and that is precisely what we understand as well, and that is what makes the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ so important, because we are told in the scriptures that God became man in Jesus Christ, and as the angels declared to the shepherds, he is a Savior who is the Messiah and the Lord, and everything in the Old Testament prophecies is and will be fulfilled in him.
That is our message
of the gospel.
Albert, how is the campaign going, by the way?
Well, I understand what you mean. I resist the use of the word campaign. Let me remind you, this came up out of
maybe
a prayer
guide. Maybe we should use the word crusade.
But it is an ongoing effort to seek to present the gospel to all persons, to the Jews as well as to the Gentiles, just as we find in the New Testament. As Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to the Jew first and also to the Gentiles.
Do you know if you're converting many Jews to this faith?
I am glad to say I know of many Jews who have come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Messiah. They know him as Savior and as Lord. They still have a Jewish mother and a Jewish father. They still consider themselves ethnically Jewish, but they know the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. They know that he is the answer to their need. They know that he is the Lord of all and that he is the Messiah.
And you do not condemn them, do you, Rabbi Heyer?
Well, they have a right to do what they want if they do it in an honest way, in a straightforward, without deception. As I pointed out before, no, but when they use the symbols of the Jewish people, that is an act of deception, to try to convert Jews by, you knock on the door, and maybe you wear a talus, or you invite somebody to a church, and you're blowing the shofar.
You think Southern Baptists are knocking on doors wearing taluses?
Look at the book they put out, If I didn't look closely at that book, I would think it was put out by some synagogue. Using the terminology, that's not the way you want to be straight about it. Knock on the door and say, I'm a believer in Jesus Christ, will you join me? Don't give them this thing about Jewish symbols. And the other thing I point out, which I think is very important, you ask them how the campaign is going. You know, there have been campaigns. The world has tried to get Jews out of this universe for thousands of years. I would only say, if we survived Auschwitz, we'll survive this campaign.
That's a little harsh, isn't it?
But no, we'll survive the test.
Do you want to end Judaism, Albert?
No, I want to see the gospel proclaimed to all persons, and the ethnic identity of the person who comes to Christ is absolutely without any theological significance whatsoever. I believe the Jewish people will continue as an ethnic people. As a matter of fact, there are promises in the scripture concerning the future of the Jewish people and the fact that there will be a great incoming and ingathering of the nation of Israel. I firmly believe that in the time to come, as the Lord accomplishes his work, we're going to see a massive turning to Christ on the part of the Jews. So
pick up from that. I got you. We'll come right back with more after this. Don't go away. We're back, Mount Pleasant, Texas. Hello.
Yes. Hi, Larry.
Hi.
I noticed that the Southern Baptists seem to have targeted the major world religions. You mentioned the Hindu, the Muslim,
right,
and the Jew. However, I noticed that the Buddhist was not mentioned, and I wondered if they were left out for a reason, and if so, what could this be?
Albert Mohler, not the Buddhists?
No, we're not leaving anyone out. As a matter of fact, the issue raised here, just about three prayer guides that have been developed by our International Mission Board, and very well done. I'm sure there will be others in the series as well. We are not targeting some groups to the exclusion of others. We believe all persons are in need of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, that he is the one righteous one, the only one who was righteous. He fulfilled all the righteous demands of the law, died on Calvary's cross to pay the penalty for our sin, and all who believe in him and claim his name will receive the gift of everlasting life.
Rabbi Boteach, since you have such regard for the Christian faith and have quoted it eloquently here tonight, maybe you'd be more open to the fact that they can proselytize.
You know, Larry, people can proselytize, but the question is, why are they targeting groups that already have faith? Why do they consider my faith an inferior faith? That's what's troubling. We live in a country of about 280 million people. They watch 2 or 3 hours of television every night. They go to shopping malls on Sundays. Do you know how many people purporting to be Christians never go to church? Why aren't they being targeted? I mean, what do they want from the Jews? Why don't, you know, when I was rabbi at Oxford University for 11 years, whenever a Christian student came to talk to me about faith, I sent them to a priest. That was the kind of brotherhood that existed between me and the Christian chaplains. I don't know why Reverend Mola doesn't target all those who claim to be Christian who have no Christian faith. I mean, what troubles me here is that Moses, who was the great prophet, is described as the most humble man that walked the earth. Where's the humility here? Religion is about feeling a proximity to God, your own insignificance. Why? All we hear is these superior claims of the two Christian representatives.
Are you saying, Albert Mola, that the Jew is inferior?
Absolutely not.
If he does not believe in Christ?
No, there's a lot of flack being thrown up in the air here by the rabbis.
Is Jewish faith inferior?
And in particular, Rabbi Boteach. The fact is, we don't believe that any is superior or inferior. My humility comes from the fact that I know I'm in need of a Savior, and I did not come up with this gospel. I didn't come up with this understanding of the need for a Savior. This is revealed in Scripture. I have no other option than humbly to believe and to teach what Scripture teaches. And that's what I'm doing here tonight. I
Rabbi
know it's Heyer, offensive
have you ever
to some
been
persons.
Moved to think in another way?
No. And
never?
No, and never.
You ever questioned your faith?
Oh, every good Jew or good Christian, I imagine, should ask questions. We should not be robots. There are things the great prophet Job did nothing else but question.
Have you ever thought that maybe Christ is the Messiah?
No, because of the fact that Christ is portrayed as divine and the Son of God. Now, I believe in a God that doesn't, frankly, need any assistance.
Have you
he
ever thought
no
that maybe he
no
isn't?
Daughters.
Of course. But, you know, most people who make decisions about Jesus do so in abysmal ignorance, never read the New Testament, don't know what Jesus
and
taught.
And what decision do they make?
Well, I'd like to challenge everybody to read the New Testament before making up their mind about Jesus. Give yourself
you know
a chance
Judaism
to hear.
Well? Have you read the Old
Not
Testament?
Well enough, and that's one of the things about Judaism.
You never know it well enough, right?
Right. We'll get some final thoughts. Hold on, Rabbi. We'll come right back after this. Don't go away. Rabbi Boteach, do you, for want of a better term, fear this, for want of a better term, crusade?
Absolutely, Larry. The greatest danger to the future of civilization is religious extremism. Religion is meant to breed humility, kindness, openness, tolerance. Then why do we see so many groups who are advocating intolerance? And the danger isn't only going to come from people who will blow themselves up on buses and take innocent victims with them. It's going to come from anyone who believes that their faith makes them more righteous. Religious righteousness has always been a nefarious movement.
But Albert
we Jews
Mola
have really paid the price.
Albert Mola hasn't said anything intolerant tonight, has he?
Larry, he said I could be a good person and as a Jew because I don't believe in Christ, I'm going to hell. I mean, I'm going to burn forever and ever. I'm not just going to suffer for 5 minutes, 10 minutes.
I guess that's intolerant.
This is Club Med forever.
All right, David Brittman,
I think it's the height of intolerance.
Do you believe that Rabbi Boteach is going to hell?
I believe that all of us are going to hell, but God is in the business of saving us. And that's why
you're saved and he's not.
That's why he sent Jesus the Messiah.
So you're saved and he's not.
I've got my sins forgiven. I don't know how Rabbi Boteach is having his sins forgiven.
So in your opinion,
that's between him and God. And I'm not the one who judges Rabbi Boteach.
But you're making a judgment here. You're telling us if he doesn't accept Christ, he's in trouble.
Well, Jesus made that judgment, and that's the point. I believe that the teachings of the New Testament are clear. Jesus is the way to have our sins forgiven.
Rabbi Heyer, do you think you're going to heaven?
That's up to God. But I
you
do
think.
I would no, I would believe that it depends on the kind of life that people live. People are judged on deeds.
The kind of life that
I think it would be presumptuous for me to be in to take a crack at whether I'm going to heaven or not. That's in God's domain. But I will say to the Southern Baptists, love us, but don't smother us. We know you're there, and if you really love us, we know your telephone. If we need you, we'll call you. But don't try to smother us, because as I said in the beginning, There were times in Jewish history where we really needed some help, and there was nobody there. And now we're just coming out of the post-Holocaust. There's a renaissance in Jewish life. Let us be. If we need help, and if we're misdirected, and we need to call somebody that we want a new religion, we'll be the first to get on the line. We've done okay for 3,500 years, and I think we'll be here for another 3,500 years.
And Albert Moeller, what would you say to the rabbi in response?
I would say that the Lord Jesus Christ himself said that we are to go into all the world and make disciples of all the nations. Larry, I believe that we who are Christians will face God and give an answer for whether or not we did everything within our power to tell as many people as possible about God's offer of salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. We want, by God's grace, to be able to give a good answer. We pray to see men and women, young persons, old persons, persons of all ethnic backgrounds come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, for he is the Messiah and the Savior of the world.
Do you think, Albert, that your predecessors might pay a price for segregationist policies
when judgment comes? The church is never perfect, and we must be instructed by God's word, and we need to be corrected by God's word. And yet the church will be made perfect when the Lord Jesus Christ comes to receive us, to claim his church, and to clothe us in his own righteousness.
Thank you all very much for an enlightening hour. We are out of time. This subject will not go away. Tomorrow night, Jeffrey Toobin discusses his very controversial new book about the Clinton presidency, and William Ginsburg is going to be here on Friday. CNN Newsstand is next, and they're going to discuss racial profiling by police in America. I'm Larry King for my guests. Thanks for joining us. Good night.